Right, welcome to this review for Khorne Daemonkin Codex. So in this video I'm going to review the codex here. I doubt whether I'm going to collect this arm. I do like the theme behind it, and the colour scheme is particularly nice, as you see here on the front cover. That kind of browny glowing red, the rusty golds and silvers is a nice strong theme to it. So I'm going to review the codex from the point of view of, if I had an army, you know, I'll go to the units, I'll show you the sort of units that I would choose, the overall philosophy of what an army would look like, and its function, and so that's the kind of route that I'm going to take it from. And then also, it's handy to know, if you're ever fighting against these, it'd be handy for me to know, like, what I'm up against and what kind of capabilities the army has. So, we'll review the codex here, and you'll get an idea, if I was to put a force together, you'll get an idea of what kind of route I would go down. Half of it would be the actual look and theme of the model and the armies, and then the other half would be obviously the tactics and the potential to try and actually win games. So I've got this codex from gamingfigures.com. They do Games Workshop at 15% off the retail price, and if your order comes to over £100, they give you an extra 5% off on top of that as well, and in the UK there's free postage as well. They don't just do Games Workshop stuff, they've got a load of other stuff on there as well. So what we'll do is we'll run through the codex here, and we'll get an idea of how good this codex and the units are. So nice artwork here on the front. So this is Chaos. It's going to be an army that's going to immediately show me it's going to be nasty, tough. It's not going to show any mercy, something that you should be terrified of. That's the kind of theme and the look of it, and that's what you want to echo in the army that you have. You don't want an army that people are going to laugh at. You want an army that looks menacing and terrifying, and that's so covered in different things that you wonder what kind of weaponry and things does it have. You know, it's not altogether clear. A clean-cut space marine, he has a bolter, but with these you can hide things in amongst them, and I like that idea of sort of an unknown enemy as well. So here's again, it's colour palette for you here. These reds, the sturdy kind of reds, the blood-stained kind of look, the sickly kind of skin, the regular kind of metal, and then this gold as well. That's really the kind of colour scheme that you can try and echo, and what I would try and echo as well if I had a force. That's the kind of armour you want, something that's terrifying. It's good fun to play against. You know, you've got an army that's, you know, clean-cut space marines, Imperial Guard, and you're going to try and stop these things before they get too close. Sort of like that idea. Scary one here, Eldar Guardians being massacred. Bit of overkill already, 10 Guardians against, looks like about 3,000 points worth of stuff there. So I wouldn't like to be in their shoes. There's some more artwork here. So get an idea of the kind of sky colour schemes. Fighting against Necrons here. Fascinating. It's all mixed units. Yes, you've got these renegade type marines, but also you've got these other unique units that you can have. Some weird artwork here. Coming through, fighting against the Tyranids. Then you got the common thing in the codexes at the moment, they cover each individual unit for you. Chaos Space Marines. So I really am going to go for units that I like the look of that will enhance the overall theme of the force. But we'll see as we go through. There are some units in here that I really like, and others that have there's no way I'd include them. Just don't like the look of them. Chaos Cultists. It's helpful. The Dark Vengeance set that Games Workshop did, or still do, it's excellent for those now. And there's some Chaos Space Marines in there as well that look really nice. I'll probably use bits from that for definite, because the sculpting, that's really nice. The Raptors, the new models, look very, very nice. Warp Turns as well. Flesh Hounds, Bikers, Battle Tanks. So I would, with Chaos, you can go down the route of, you know, space marine vehicles that have been corrupted and possessed and so on, and you can go for that kind of thing, or you can move away and do less kind of regular space marines and more of the unique units. Maybe try and get a balance between the two. Defilers there, soul grinders, all of Skarl's Forge Fiends fought against these, against Brian's Night Lords. Rate that unit. So the different colour palettes here for you, with markings and so on. Interesting. Brazen Beasts, the Harvest. Blood Gorged. The Eight Scarred. Yeah, there's the look there. And these new miniatures here, giving Khorne Daemonkin something big to feature. Yeah, so as we go through it, some units are loved, some units do not like and wouldn't include, but we'll see as we go along. Here's the new miniatures here, this incredible kit, and a number of options that you can turn it into. Lord of Skulls, a lot of people don't like it. I think it's alright. I wouldn't say I don't like it. No, I would, I like this head more. And the colour scheme's not. I think that colour scheme is how I would try and do the whole army. So it's reddy, browny red, all sort of highlighted and glowing. The dirty sort of colouring of the skulls and the metal work, and then this gold trim. That is my colour palette, I think, for the entire force. Get it to match in to that. It's the kind of thing. The theme for the army would be something that an army that kind of. You see half of it and the rest of it materialises later on in the game and overwhelms you. So you see some units kind of ordering and suddenly these other units turn up and you get overwhelmed and they burst in and the terrifying slaughter can begin. I think I really would go for a close combat, so short-ranged weaponry for a lot of the army, and then for nasty close combat and just slaughter an opponent and put terror into them. You know, you get so close and charge in and just begin smashing everything up. It just... be a terrifying. You can imagine it being a terrifying experience, and that's the kind of theme I want to echo. I wouldn't want just like equivalent of a Space Marine army, but just as chaos. I would want to go for some of the more unique units. So Blood Host Detachment then. These are covered in the formation later on. A Slaughter Cult, one Chaos Lord, one Herald, Demon Prince, Bloodthirster of Unfettered Fury. 2 to 8 units of Chaos Space Marines. So, Berserkers, Bloodletters, in any combination. 1 to 4 units of Possessed, you have to take Possessed. 0 to 2 units of Spawn and Cultists. So, kind of restricting you there. It may be sort of off what I'm aiming for. And you can add all these bits to it. If you do go down this route, you get Blood Frenzy at the beginning of each of your turns before deciding whether or not to expend any blood first or blood type points. You automatically generate 1 additional blood type. Okay, so a little bit of a bonus there. Chosen of Khorne, if this detachment is your primary detachment, you can reroll the result and roll on the warlord trait. There's some slight additions there. Not massive. So that's just down to your own preference. I usually go about, I don't build an army based on this or based on any formations. I usually build an army how I want it to be, and then possibly tweak it slightly to fit in with some bits. But usually I just like to build an army how I like it and go from there, and sometimes it fits automatically into some of the formations. Anyway, war gear list, we'll come back to that later. So I'm not going to cover in depth every single unit here, but I'm going to lean towards the units that I would, the route that I would go down for building a force. So Chaos Lord, first of all. The model's okay. Obviously Terminator armor. So 75 points. Weapon skill 6, ballistic skill 5, strength for toughness 4, 3 wounds, initiative 5, 3 attacks. All pretty standard. Power armor, bolt pistol, close combat weapon, and then the grenades. So special rules then. Blood for the Blood God. We'll look these up now, because these are rules that are going to apply throughout the army. We'll see how this works. So Blood for the Blood God. A Khorne Daemonkin army generates blood type points during the course of each battle. A Controlling player must keep a record of how many points his army accrues. Blood type points generated each time one of the following events occurs. So you add up these points, keep a tally of them, and I think you get to spend them. So a unit containing at least one model with the blood for the Blood God special is completely destroyed or destroys an enemy unit. So if you die or you kill an opposing enemy unit and you have that special, you get 1 point. A character with the blood for the Blood God special rule is slain or slays an enemy character in a challenge. Right, so immediately this is hinting that I should aim, or that you should aim for close combat and killing characters. You get more points for doing it. Maximum number of blood type points an army can have any one time is 8. Any additional points generated are lost. The controlling player can choose to expend blood type points at the start of any of his turns. To do so, pick one reward on the blood type table that has a value equal to or less the number of blood type points. When one or more blood type points are expended, any remaining points are lost, though more points can be generated. Right, so if you have 7 and you go for the 5 options, you'll lose the other 2. So you just aim to try and spend as many as you can. So we'll go through this because I think it's really important. Your army kind of revolves around this to a certain degree, and the idea is actually quite cool. Remember what I said about this idea: if you have a force, but it keeps other things materialize as the army moves up. This you can sort of do this here. So 1 point. Infernal Contempt. All friendly units the Blood for the Blood God special have adamantium special rule to start the next turn. Okay, so not bad, but not much. 2. Insatiable Bloodlust. I mean, you can get this turn 2 onwards. You lose a couple of you kill a target or you lose a unit. You're going to start knocking up these points quite quick. Insatiable Bloodlust are 2. All friendly units of the Blood for the Blood God special rule have Furious Charge and Rage until the start of your next turn. So even 2 points used up is pretty good. Unstoppable Ferocity. All friendly units with the rule have Feel No Pain. Again, pretty good. Apocalyptic Fury on a fuse 4 points. All friendly units have that special rule add 1 to their attacks characteristic. Again, pretty good. So I think 2 is quite good. Demon Tide. On a 5, a unit consisting of either 8 blood letters or 5 flesh hounds is summoned. Within 12, any friendly unit with. Right, so you're going to get a unit of 8. Right, it's so cool just getting 3 units of stuff. Love that idea in armies. I do it with other forces, especially with Necrons, generate new models, and you can do it here. Harbingers of Blood and Brass. A unit consisting of either 3 blood crushers or a skull cannon is summoned within 12 of any friend unit of the Blood for the Blood God special rule. So three blood crushers. So why I take interest in this is because I'm going to try and build an army that has these in it already, so that just for the practical point, when you come to regenerate, the chances are that unit could be off the table. And it's been destroyed, it comes back again. You haven't had to go out and buy an extra unit to do this. It's already in your army. The blood crushers say you deliberately throw them at the opposing force on a suicide charge or whatever, trying to accomplish something, but they die and they just come back again because they're already in the army. They already have them painted, and you save your points up and wait until the last one's killed, and then you just bring them back. Dark Apotheosis. Choose one friendly character with the special rule who does not have the Demon of Khorne special rule on the board. That character must immediately take a leadership test. If the test is failed, a Chaos Spawn is summoned within 6 of that character. If the test is passed, a Demon Prince equipped with Warforged Armor and Demonic Flight, if the model being used is to represent it has wings, is summoned within 6. So again, it's a model 2, including the army. In either case, the chosen character is removed as a casualty. If the chosen character was your warlord, your opponent does not earn slay the warlord. Furthermore, the Demon Prince will retain any warlord trait and artifacts of slaughter which your warlord had. So one friendly character, even like a Chaos Space Marine Sergeant, could even do that. So yeah, incredible bonuses here. Terrifying, fun to play against and to play with. Number 8 then, Fury Unbound. Choose one friendly character with the special rule who does not have the Demon of Khorne rule. That character must immediately take leadership tests. If the test is failed, the model is immediately removed as a casualty. If the test is passed, a Bloodthirster of Unfettered Fury is summoned within 6 inches of the character, and then the chosen character is removed as a casualty. If the chosen character is your warlord and passed his leadership test, your opponent does not earn Slay the Warlord until newly summoned model is removed as a casualty. Furthermore, the Bloodthirster will retain any warlord trait your warlord had. So, a Bloodthirster of Unfettered Fury. Okay, right, interesting. So, I would try and build an army that has all of those elements in it, so that you're able to do that. Because I think that's, that the amount of points you can generate from that is brilliant. So, that's partly going to control how I build the army. So, come back to that then. So he had Blood to the Blood God, he has Fearless, which is handy. Mark of Khorne, we'll check these out, 110. Mark of Khorne has Rage and Counterattack, so that's good for them. And then Skulls for the Skull Friend. So again, Rage, that role is really going to gear you towards trying to get into combat. Skulls for the Skull Friend. A model with Skulls for the Skull Friend special rule must always issue and accept challenges. Okay, no problem, that's alright. So it's, you want to be hiding with your characters. You want to gear them up so that they are geared up to fight and challenges and to win. So you can take melee weapons, ranged weapons, Gifts of Khorne, special issue war gear and Artifacts of Slaughter. I may come back to them in a minute. Alternatively, Chaos Lord may replace all of his war gear with Terminator armour. Power Weapon and Combi Bolter, so 40 points to do that. And then you can take a limited number of upgrades from that. Modern Terminator Armor can replace his Combi Bolter with Combi Flame Melter or Plasma, Power Weapon, Lightning Claw, and so on. Just standard stuff here. We'll just check out, I think the rules are all going to be the same. We'll check out Axe of Khorne here, it's 20 points. We'll see if that's any good. Axe of Khorne then is here. Strength of the user, it's AP2. And Decapitating Blow, it's a specialist weapon. On a roll of 6, then it's instant death. Well, that's not bad, it's 20 points. You may want to go down that route. So, we're probably going to come to these later on, so check out these weapons here that you can equip him with. You can, looks like you can customise them pretty heavily. So melee weapons. Chain axe, we'll check these out. So you can give him a chain axe, it's 8 points to take that. It's strength for the user, AP4 melee. Okay, not particularly impressive. If you're going to try and give it to a Chaos Lord, it's not too impressive. Lightning Claw. It's just going to be the same. Power Weapon, Power Fist, Axe of Khorne. Okay, that's fine. Then ranged weapons. Combi Bolter, Combi Flamer, Melter of Plasma and Plasma Pistol. That's fine. And then next, Gifts of Khorne. Right, so these are some unique ones here. Ichor Blood. Ichor Blood, a unit that causes 1 or more unsafe wounds on a model with Ichor Blood during the fight sub phase immediately takes a strength 3 AP4 hit. Alright. Okay, pretty, not really worth bother with that. Say 5 points, but it's a rule you'd easily forget. But if you have a spare 4 or 5 points somewhere, then you can use that up. Aura of Dark Glory is 15 points. 5 plus Imbun. Okay, right, well, that's not bad. Next is Collar of Khorne. A unit containing one or more models of Collar of Khorne has a plus 2 bonus to any Deny the Witch rolls. Okay, not bad. That's 15 points. Combat Familiar. And you get 2 additional Strength 4 AP dash hits in combat. Again, that's a waste of points, really. It would be better if you got the extra 2 attacks, you know, that character with his weapons, but it's not, it's just 2 attacks of Strength 4 AP, nothing. And it's 15 points, so I wouldn't bother. A Juggernaut of Khorne just becomes a Juggernaut, and it receives plus 1 toughness, plus 1 wound, plus 1 attack, and become cavalry. I think that would be worth it to put him on a Juggernaut of Khorne. Yeah, pretty cool. Okay. Just this early stage, just seeing the unique weaponry that's available to this Chaos Force here. Gifts of Khorne. Special issue war gear. Melter bombs, jump pack, chaos bike. Okay. Sigil of Corruption. A 4 plus in fun. Okay. So probably take that on him. That will cost you 25 points. Okay. So you can customise him quite well. But, for your HQ, personally, I think something bigger and nastier would be better. Special gifts of Khorne. Artifacts will come to later on. And then special issue walking. Okay, so we've covered that. So I'd say, yeah, maybe for him, but I think there's better stuff out there. So, Demon Prince. And yeah. So I would build this Demon Prince and then I would equip him with Warpforged armor, Demonic Flight as well. And I'd have him to fit that setup, how he's specified there. So we'll just see, it's 160 points. This is more the kind of terrifying kind of thing that you want. His weapon skill 9. Ballistic skill 5, strength 6, toughness 5, 4 wounds, initiative 8, 5 attacks, and leadership 9. There's no save. He has a close combat weapon, but his attacks are going to be AP 2 for being a monstrous creature. And then he gets Blood for the Blood God, Demon of Khorne. Oh, he's going to get 5 plus in 1 like demons do. His Furious Charge, Hatred. Okay, so he's pretty good. Pretty good, pretty tough. He has Deep Strike, has Fearless, and Skulls for the Skull Throne. Okay, so this guy comes with. So you can take the artifacts later on. So probably wouldn't bother with any of the gifts. Just check they've been through those already. Warp Forged Armor. God of Fear, you're going to want to take this. Warp Forged Armor then is a 3 plus armor save. Yep. We'll definitely take that. It's 20 points. It's worth the points for him. And then Demonic Flight. He just become a flying monstrous creature. Yep. So take those upgrades. That will push him up to 220 points. He's a nasty HQ, and he's someone that can come back if you get enough points. So you're bound to get up to that number of points to get him back again. So I think he would be the HQ. There's a Herald here. He's only 55 points. For weapon skill and ballistic skill 7, strength 5, toughness 4, 2 wounds, initiative 6, three attacks, leisure 8 and a 6 plus save. He has a Hellblade, we'll look that up. He looks quite cool. His weapon's just here, it's a Hellblade. Strength of the user, it's AP 3 and melee. And he's strength 5, so pretty good. Strength 5 power weapon, really. Blood for Logod, Demon of Khorne. So he's got an Invuln save. And Hatred and so on. He has Deep Strike, he has Fearless. Independent character, Scarf's the Scarf Run. So you can take gifts of Khorne, we've been through that, but Loki of Khorne here, artifacts will come to later, but Loki of Khorne, we'll check them out to see if they are any good. So you've got Loki of Khorne here, so you can have the Lesser Locus of Abjuration. That will give you Adamantium Will, okay, not too bad. The Greater Locus of Fury. The model and all units in the unit have Rage. That's good if it's a big unit. It will cost you 20 points. Not bad. If it's a big enough unit, it'd be worth it. An Exalted Locus of Wrath is 25 points, and that will give you Hatred. Okay. Well, the Fury one's quite good with Rage, if you stick her in a big enough unit. So, yeah, it's interesting enough. But I think my HQ is going to be taken up by our stuff. Yeah, he's taken up a slot, so maybe we'd leave him. And he's not particularly big for an HQ. I'm saying things that are big and terrifying as part of the thing. Right, next up on HQ is this Blood Throne, 130 points. I'm going to bypass it here because just I do not like the look of it. I can tell here that it is a chariot. Yeah, chariots aren't as good now. You can blow the chariot away and the character dies. I don't particularly like the look of it at all. Armor 12, no. So I'm gonna bypass that. I don't think that's gonna terrify an opponent. Just looks a bit weird. You don't want that. You want that mean kind of look to your force. Skull Taker again, not keen. On the look of him, but too small. I think there's bigger and more intimidating units that you can take for HQ, so I'll leave that one as well. This is the kind of thing that I think is going to make your army look terrifying. Something that's so out of proportion big. It's a lot of points, 250 points, but I think that's the way to go, to have something so big, such a focal point. Now, if you remember, we go back to here. Let's just check to see what you can get. It is a Bloodthirst of Unfettered Fury. So I would just go down the route of having that. Instead of having to buy different models, I would get the Bloodthirst of Unfettered Fury because there's a number of options that you can take. I'm sure they're all good. I think that's the one that I would sculpt, would build, so that if it dies, I can save up the points and then replace it during the game. And you'll get 250 point unit back. It's not upgrades for this, so it's a flat 250 points. It looks impressive, but is it any good? So, weapon skill 10, ballistic skill 10, that's a good start. Strength 6, toughness 6, 5 wounds, initiative 9, 6 attacks, leadership 9, and a 3 plus save. It's a flying monstrous creature. It's a terrifying thing. You'd even be tempted to sculpt it, mount it on a base. High up, so a couple of rocks, a good few inches up, a couple of rocks, and then mount it up really, really high, and just let your opponent just stand in awe of it. And if he shoots at it, all well and good, because you can get the points back and then bring them back again. Warpforged Armor, so we know that's a 3 plus save, he's got it here anyway. He has Blood for the Blood God, Demon of Khorne, he's got an Invuln save, he's got Fearless, Hatred, so on. You can Deep Strike. So if this thing dies and you have the points and it comes back, you can fly on or it can deep strike down. Fearless, Skulls of the Skull Throne. And then these two weapons, this axe and this lash, will be interesting to see what they can do. So Lash of Khorne, first of all, on page 113. Lash of Khorne. That will give you, it's range 12, it's actually a shooting attack. and it's strength 6, AP 2. So just one shooting weapon. But handy enough, strength 6, AP 2, if he's going to go up against a monstrous creature or something, he can knock a wound off. He's bound to hit. And if strength 6, AP 2, he'd probably do some damage. So that's not bad, because it's mounted on something that's ballistic skill 10. So you're going against an opponent, he's got 4 wounds, you could knock a wound down with the whip before you charge in. So handy enough. And let me think now, you can fly over the top of something and use the whip as well. Okay, I'm just thinking now, if he's a character, he can make precision shots possibly, so you might be able to use the whip to take out a character or a sergeant or something as he flies over the top. So Axe of Khorne now, check out to see how good that is. Axe of Khorne is strength of the user, so it'll be strength 6, AP 2. Excellent, it's a melee weapon, a specialist weapon, decapitating blow, and he rolls, any wound rolls of 6 will have instant death. Yeah, so that is a decent enough weapon. You've got such a high amount of attacks here, that the probability of getting a 6 is quite high. So he goes on against a big tyrannid monstrous creature and he rolls that 6 to wound, just take the model off. That's pretty cool. Yeah, it's pretty good. If they don't make their save, if they don't have an invun, there's going to be big trouble. So yeah, he's good. He's good in combat, and he's fast. He'll be quite hard to kill. So decent enough. Not totally unstoppable, but a nasty thing, and just the sheer presence and size of the thing. He's good, and that you without that blood type point straw, you need to be worried about how is he going to get shot. I've got to protect him, but now you can just let him loose, and if he dies, you just can bring him back. So cool. So we'll just check out here the other two, the ones that I wouldn't have gone for. See how good they are. So Bloodthirster of the Insensate. Rage, 275 points. We're expecting something better here. Toughness six. Yeah, all about the same. A warp forged armor. Okay, it's the Great Axe of Khorne. Let's have a look here. Great Axe of Khorne. Oh, it's a D weapon. That's horrendous. Yeah, so that this with this addition to the codex, this puts this army up there. You got a nasty creature that can yield a D weapon axe. Colossal. Model of this weapon piles in and fights initiative step 1. Fair enough. But D weapon. These Bloodthirsters. Insensate rage that can take on anything, and you can expect the damage to be horrendous. Terrifying looking thing, and a terrifying weapon. Excellent. And that's the kind of thing you want your opponent to go, oh, it's a D weapon, isn't it? That fear, if you can accomplish that, then that matches the theme of this force. Demon of Khorne, Deep Strike, Fearless, Rage. So, extra attacks there. He's good. They're all good, but he is good. Wrath of Khorne, Bloodthirster. Yeah, it looks pretty cool. They all look good. 300 points for this guy. Same stat line. Hellfire. Let's see what that is. A Hellfire. Strength 5, AP 4. Template weapon. Soul Blades. Pretty good. Okay. Yeah. So flamer attack weapon. As he flies over something, he can do that. Okay, pretty good. A Blood Flail. Which will be this thing here. Is range 12, strength 7, AP 2, assault D3. So he could do some brilliant shooting attacks here actually as he flies over. He can fire 2 weapons as a monstrous creature. But he can also use it in combat. It's AP 2, melee and specialist weapon. It's AP 2 anyway for being a monstrous creature. But it may grant him an extra attack here. We'll see. Yeah, with the Axe of Khorne. Which we've seen already. It's the same weapon as this guy. Okay. So again, pretty good from him. He has hatred for characters. Fearless Deep Strike. and so on. So they're all really good, but building the force based on that blood type points, I would go for this guy. And making the warlord, if he comes back in, you know, your opponent's not going to get that point. So that's it for HQ. Some good choices here. The bigger the better, I think, for Khorne Daemonkin. Right, so going to go on to troops here. And I think I would try and paint the contents of the Dark Vengeance set. So you get some Chaos Space Marines, and you get Chaos Cultists in with it. They're 6 points each. I think they're an excellent way to fill out your force. If you're spending out on some big HQs and so on, I think some Cultists, build them in a way where your opponents are going to ignore them because they're so cheap. And then, but they're there, they can hold objectives and just, you know, sit around. Or you can use them as a screen, they're a throwaway unit. Or an easy way of collecting these blood type points, just chuck them in as a shield ball, as a meat ball, let them get destroyed and blown away, knock up some points. But just check them out here. Stat line of a guardsman, really. Improvised armor, I imagine is going to be a 6 plus. Yeah, 6 plus. That's here anyway. Auto pistol, close combat weapon. And then Blood for the Blood God, yeah, you can generate the points from them. You can give them flames, heavy stubbers. Shotgun champion, you can take one of them. You can take auto guns. So you can take, you have a unit of 8 to 58 points. You can add up to 27 additional cultists. You can have a massive load of them. I'd say smaller units perhaps, because you want them to die. For them, Chaos Space Marines then. They're 15 points, they're 1 point more than a regular Space Marine. Same stat line. Yep. And same equipment. But they get Blood for the Blood God, they get Mark of Khorne, they get Skulls for the Skull Throne. Okay. So, they get this Rage. So they're quite good. Again, like regular Marines, but a little bit of an extra edge in combat. You get a unit of 8 for 130 points. That's a nice size, actually. Unit of 8. We want it quite small that it's not spending too many points. Plus, if it dies, you get your points for it. You can take a close combat weapon for 2 points a time. Probably wouldn't bother with that. Any model means to replace his bolt gun with a close combat weapon. 1 Chaos Space Marine would choose one of the following options. You can take a plasma pistol, 15 points. Or you can take special weapons. You can take special weapons, heavy weapons. You may want to go down the route of that. The aspiring champion may take melee weapons, ranged weapons. You can take melter bombs on the aspiring champion. One model unit may take an Icon of Wrath. 15. Right, when determining assault results, add 1 to your total if there are 1 or more friendly units with an Icon of Wrath locked in that combat. Okay. In addition, all models of the Mark of Khorne unit equipped with an Icon of Wrath have Furious Charge. Furthermore, when determining its charge range, you can re-roll the results. It's quite a good thing to take, actually. Quite a few enhancements to that. It is 20 points, so it's probably something worth adding to a bigger unit. And you can make big units here. Unit of 8, and you can add 12. So you can have a unit of 20, which is interesting. You can take a Chaos Rhino, if you wish. It's quite standard on the infantry. I like the idea of Chaos Cultists. There's other infantry choices here for them. Okay. So, I mean, regular Chaos Space Marines, they're okay. But I'd be probably tempted to go down the route of something more unique, away from regular, anything that's regular Space Marine. I might take a few, but we'll see what else we've got here. So, Berserkers, it's almost, well, I would feel it's compulsory almost to have these, because it matches so well with the theme of Khorne Daemonkin. To have these Berserkers. So 162 points for 8 of them. They're 19 points a time. Weapon skill 5. It gives them a little bit of an edge in combat. All the standard gear. They are fearless though, and they have Furious Charge. Okay. Pretty good. Okay, so you can take a chain axe. Just check that out. It's AP4 melee weapon. So, not bad. If your aim is to go after medium to light infantry with these, then those chain axes will help you glide through the army. You know, if guardsmen with their army, you can glide through with a chain axe. So that's an option to take. It's only 3 points. You just might want to give a few of those out. And you can give it to any of them. Up to 2 berserkers may replace their bolt pistol with plasma pistol. Again, you can take, a champion can take melee or ranged weapons. You can take melter bombs. You can take the icon again. They probably may not need to bother because of, they get the fearless furious charge anyway. So again, quite average of them. So you want to use them to bulk out your force. I'd maybe take a unit of about 8 and chuck them in against medium to light infantry. Give them a few of these chain axes and then select the right target to go for. Delivery for them. It's quite awkward, really. Yeah, delivery is kind of an awkward one. You think maybe a land raider perhaps might be the route to go down. A lot more inclined towards an army that's going to appear close to your opponent. So deep strike capability, I think, is going to be important. Right, so next is bloodletters, and I do like the look of these. I played a game some years ago against a Chaos Demons player, and he deep strike loads of these units just turned up all around his plane. Actually, he was using Elder at the time, and it was all quiet on the battlefield, and then suddenly all these units of bloodletters just deep strike next to my force, and it's just really impressive just to see loads of them. I like the idea of doing that, so we'll try and reflect that in this force. And that's the kind of units I was saying that I'd like to materialise. You advance up, your opponent gets ready to fight against this force, and then suddenly all these other units begin to materialise. That'd be cool. So bloodletter then, is it worth it? They're 10 points a time. Skill 5, ballistic skill 5, that's a good start. Strength 4, toughness 3, 1 wound, initiative 4, 1 attack, leadership 7, 6 plus save. They have Hellblades, they're AP3 weapons, power sword equipped, so 10 points, pretty good. It's very good indeed. Blood for the Blood God, Demon of Khorne, they're going to get those bonuses there, including the invuln save. They can deep strike, so you can do this appearing thing. They're fearless as well, so you've got to kill them to get rid of them. Like, I really like the idea of this. You can add, that's for 8, 80 points for 8, and then you can add to 12 more, so up to 20 in a unit. You can upgrade to a Blood Reaper for only 5 points, gives you an extra attack. Okay. One bloodletter may take an Instrument of Chaos. Let's see how well we can enhance these here. So an Instrument of Chaos. When a unit of an Instrument of Chaos in Deep Strike Reserve successfully passes its reserve role, you can also choose another unit. This unit must be entirely composed of models of the Demon Special Role, still in Deep Strike Reserve, yet to make a reserve role this turn. The unit chosen unit automatically arrives. So so Instrument of Chaos, you can give it to each of the units, then they can all start turning up at the same time. Yeah, it may be worth doing that. 10 points to do it. A different bloodletter may take a Banner of Blood. And that is 20 points. When determining assault results, you add 1 to your total. Okay. In addition, once per game, the unit bearing a Banner of Blood can charge d6 plus 6 instead of the usual distance. Okay, that's very handy. Furthermore, if the first model for a friendly unit arriving by Deep Strike is placed within 6, if at least one model with Banner of Blood, the following rules apply. If the unit attempts to Deep Strike is entirely composed of models of the Demon of Khorne Special, then it does not scatter. If the unit attempting to Deep Strike is entirely composed of models of a different type, it's only d6. And then no effect for others. So pretty cool. That banner's pretty good, yeah, so we think I'll take a banner. And I'll probably take 2 units of 20, something like that. And just have them turn up, and then your opponent has to deal with them. Either they distract your opponent, or they're able to run in charge and cause lots of trouble. So yeah, that's the route I go down for them. I think that'd be cool. Yeah, you'd be unit 20, just the sheer size. That's what happened to me, and I found it fascinating to play against and intimidating as well. And it also fits in, when we were talking about here, one of your results is 8 blood letters for a 5 result. So, you know, you lose lots of these, you can start ploughing them back again, which is really good. That's the only other upgrades you can take, so really you expect them just to land there and then to be able to charge in on later turns and just take on infantry, marines, and any type of infantry that's 3 plus armor or worse. Next up is Possessed here, not keen on the models. They're 30 points a time. Just looking through here, yeah, not keen on these at all. I'm going to skip them. I'm sure they're pretty good. Vessels of Chaos, we'll always have a look. Beginning of each fight subphase, or D3. So you're on 1, you'll get reroll to wounds. On 2, you're AP3. And then +1 attack and initiative on supernatural speed. So quite randomised there. Wouldn't be too keen on that. They have fleet, they're fearless. But yeah, I'd probably leave that. They're not too amazing in combat, so leave that possessed. We're on to elites at the moment. Chaos Terminators. Possibly, I don't like the spikes coming up. I mean, I could leave them out, but just not too keen on them. They're 34 points a time. They're armed with power weapons, combi bolter, terminator armor. So yeah, you could do. I'd probably try and be adventurous, take something else. But that's another option for you that you can kit out, and you can add all the gear to them. There's a Reaper autocannon here. Check that out, because I haven't looked at that yet. Right, so Reaper autocannon, strength 7, AP 4, range 36, heavy 2, and it's twin links. So it's pretty good. But it's 25 points. That's a lot of points compared to a regular autocannon. So that's a fair amount there. Okay, so another option there. What I'd be more inclined for, they look alright, but what I'd be more inclined for is, well, I think it may be a foot-based portion, unit of regular sort of Chaos Space Marines, Berserkers and Terminators to move up on foot. And it seems quite predictable on average, but then this other stuff starts appearing. I think it might be a cool idea. So Terminators, yeah, I reckon they could make it into the force. Blood Crushers. Now I rate these, the models look good. The sculpture on these beasts looks brilliant. And then the riders, they look really cool. So they're 45 points a time, 3 of them for 135 points. Weapon skill and ballistic skill 5, that's brilliant. Strength 5, toughness 4, 3 wounds, very, very good indeed. 3 attacks basic, 6 plus save. Hellblade for the weapon, but it'll be striking at strength 5. Bluff the Block, got a deep strike with these, which is interesting. Fearless, so you've got to wipe them out to get rid of them. And then Demon of Corns, got these invuns. You can take 6 more. I think 3 of them is about enough, maybe 2 units of 3. The cavalry is nice and quick. You can take an Instrument of Chaos. A Blood Hunter. Yeah, it's worth it. It's only 5 points, just gives you an extra attack. That's worth it. And then you can take a Banner of Blood, but I'd just take them just as they are. They're fearless and they're strong enough. I think they're pretty cool. Yeah, pretty good. Take 2 units for free. If they die, it just racks up your points. Now, if we go back here. Yeah, on 6 here. 3 Blood Crushers. You'll get on 6 points. So that fits in perfectly. If you take 2 units for free, one of them takes 1 casualty, another one takes 2, and then that forms a unit of 3, which can then come back if you have the points. 2 units are free, wouldn't bother about any upgrades, they're pretty good as they are. Going to hunt light vehicles and infantry with a 3 plus save, or worse for them. Probably wouldn't deep strike them, It depends, it's a nice option to have with them. There's a nice speed element to this force you can have. Chaos Spawn. You can create your own. Not too impressed with this one. I've seen some conversion work that's been done, it looks really good. So probably do your own, put your own together. At least have one, just to cover this part of the aspect of the codex in the army. It gets d6 attacks in combat, weapon skill 3, strength and toughness 5, 3 wounds. It's pretty good. It's a beast, it's going to move nice and quick. It's 32 points. So you roll in each fight sub-phase to see what you get. His armor save on a 1, his armor save goes to 4+. Or you can roll 2d6 and pick the highest for random attacks. Or your attacks become poisoned and 4+. Bit too random to rely upon it. I would just have one model just to fit the blood type table. Fearless though. Rage. Yeah, it's not bad. Not bad. Chaos Rhino. Next. I don't like the spikes, the railings. I hit it here and on top. It's just a rhino with railings on it. I just don't like it. So probably avoid the rhino. Chaos bikers. I'm sure they're just pretty much the same as regular Space Marine bikers. Yeah, all looking pretty much the same here. And there's a few upgrades that you can take for them. Again, close to Space Marines, but it's an option. So they can look quite, they look pretty good here. So yeah, it's an option to take. Flesh Hounds. They're Deep Strike, Fearless again. Got the Invuln save. 16 points a model. And I don't like the sculpting on these at all. So we'll skip over them. This would be more what I'm interested in here. In this codex there are some such nice units, and I really would capitalise on them. Raptors and Warp Talons, I think, would be one of those units. I think the Raptors look really, really nice. They're 105 points for 5. They're only 19 points a model with jump packs. Looks like it, yeah, pretty good. Regular Space Marine stats. They have the grenades, the combat weapon, power armor, bolt pistol. They cause fear. They have Mark of Khorne, Scars of the Skull Throne, Blood for the Blood God. So that's all good. Not very expensive at all. Weaponry looks nice. So up to 2 Raptors can take Flamers, Melter Guns or Plasma. Probably try and make these an assault-based unit. You can give them melee or ranged weapons. You can give them Melter Bombs. And you can give them an Icon of Wrath. So, I just include, just like the look of them. I think they'd be handy enough, nice and quick. Warp Talons. These are 34 points a time, which is a lot of points for a single wound, 3+ save figure. They get 2 lightning claws, so that's an extra attack for that. All the other upgrades, warp, flame strike, immediately after a unit of warp talons has arrived from deep strike, all enemy units within 6 counts having been hit by a weapon of the blind special roll. Okay, they look really, really nice, but they are expensive, 180 points for 5, I can imagine them just getting blown away, and not getting much of a chance to do too much damage. So, yeah, I'd probably go for raptors. Yep. Yeah, go for raptors. And just volume of hits, I think, with them. Handy enough. Right. Helldrake then for fast attack. I rate these. I rate the model. And I rate them as in the game as well. 170 points. It's front and side armor of 12. Ballistic skill 3, which is a bit of a letdown. Hull points 3, but for a flyer, they're superb. You can hover with these things, which is excellent. It's a nice maneuverability with this. Demonic Possession. I've been the victim of its attacks before. My Imperial Fists, a number of them were incinerated by this thing. But Demonic Possession. The vehicle's ballistic skill is reduced to 3. It ignores the effects of crew shaken and crew stunned. On a roll of 2+, embarked units are still affected by these results. Roll d6 each time the unit embarks on a vehicle with a demonic possession upgrade. Roll of 1, the demon devours a randomly chosen model in the unit. Okay, interesting. On a 2+, you ignore crew stunned and shaken. Excellent. It's very good. So Hades auto cannon is your standard armament. It's range 36, strength 6, AP 4 and pinning. So it's decent enough. Good anti-flyer. And if you can get around behind vehicles or to the side armour, then you're going to let out some decent shots there. So yeah, it's not bad. It has blood for the blood god, which is good. Demon of Khorne actually gets an imbun, and it gets it will not die. So cool. Very, very good. Demon Forge. Once per game at the start of any shooting or assault phase, the Demon Forge may be activated. So it's a one-off use in the game. For the rest of the phase, the model may reroll all failed to wound rolls and all failed armor penetrating rolls. The end of the phase in which the Demon Forge is used, roll a d6 and a result of a 1, you lose a whole point. So that's handy. You want to make an impact at a certain point, you just activate the Demon Forge. That's very good. Meteoric Descent. A Helldrake has Vector Strike. Furthermore, hits caused by Helldrake's Vector Strike are resolved at strength 7. So again, another little bonus for that. You can replace the autocannon with a Bale Flamer. Alright, so Bale Flamer, strength 6, AP 3, 10 plate weapon. It's Torrent, so you've got nice range in it. And Soul Blaze on top of that as well. So it's an excellent weapon. I reckon I would take 2 of these and just terrify the opponent from the skies. And again, armor saves 3+ upwards or worse. We'll be in a lot of trouble against that. You can get a nasty lot of hits, take out an entire tactical squad with one swoop. The fact that it's a flying comes on from reserve, excellent reach with it. You can come on from reserve at any point and just ambush, catch units out. So yeah, the supporting role, one of them definitely, 2 perhaps. Just to add the impact there. 170 points at a time, I think it's a decent flyer and cause a lot of trouble. Just to bear in mind that if you do drop the Hades autocannon, then you're losing your anti-flyer to some extent, so be a little bit careful. So maybe give one the Hades autocannon, the other one give them the flamer. Chaos Land Raider. It's just a Land Raider with spikes on it. I wouldn't be too fussed on that. I'd go more towards these unique units and the nasty creatures and so on. This is more what I go for. So you've got Forge Fiend, Maul of Fiend. 180 points for the Forge Fiend. So it's got to be pretty good for that. Weapon skill, ballistic skill 3. Strength 6. Front and side 12, rear 10. Initiative 3, 2 attacks, 3 hull points. 2 Hades autocannons. Demonic Possession, has Fleet, has It Will Not Die, has Demon Forge again. Right, so you can replace those autocannons with Ectoplasma Cannons for free, and you can take an extra one for 25, so push it to 205 points. So the Ectoplasma Cannon, strength 8, AP 2. Blast and get sorts. This is souped up plasma. Very, very good. And it's excellent. You get 2 of them and you can fire a 3rd. You can chuck out some nasty shots. I can imagine it do a lot of damage. It is 200 points though. I imagine it would be targeted quite heavily by your opponent. You'd see the danger of it and go after it pretty quick. But handy enough to ambush, tuck it around a building, suddenly appear and just blast away. What's the range on it? Range 24, so we get pretty close. Maul of Fiend then for close combat. Love the look of the model. Such a big model as well. 130 points for it. Gets 2 power fists though, so there's an extra attack that it will gain. Has demonic possession. 2 magma cutters. quite familiar with this because I've fought against it a few times. Magma Cutters. If a Maul of Fiendas hits with at least one attack in the fight subphase, it may make an additional attack with one of its Magma Cutters against one of the models it hit. If it hit with all of its attacks, it instead makes two additional attacks with its Magma Cutters. These attacks hit automatically and resolved initiative 1, strength 8, AP 1 and armor bane. So very good extra bonus there. So it looks like it doesn't get much, but in fact, there, so you can get a fair few attacks with it. Has fleet, has it will not die. Has move through cover. Seen this one, Demonforge, Siege Crawler. We're up to 12 in the movement phase. Brilliant. Not slowed by terrain. And it adds one to armor penetration rolls against buildings, but that is very good indeed. You can replace the Magma Cutters with Lasher Tendrils. Lasher Tendrils. Each set of Lasher Tendrils reduces the attacks characteristic of every model, friend and foe, in base contact with the bearer by one, whilst they remain in base contact. Effects of multiple sets are cumulative. For example, if a model is in base contact with two Maul of Fiends, each of them has two sets of Lasher Tendrils, it has four fewer attacks. And actually, you could really pin something down. And this is a cheap model. This is 130 points, possibly 140. So it's a definite inclusion, I would say, in the force. It's something that can start with the ground force and then move up quick. Something you could keep back, keep it on patrol. Something comes too close, you can charge out, bog it down with the Maul of Fiends. Excellent one. Defiler next. Not too keen on the model. It's 200 points. Is strength 8 basic, has 3 attacks. 4 hull points though. Armor 12. It's armed to the teeth. I mean, it's alright. 2 power fists. Twin linked heavy flamer. Reaper auto cannon. And battle cannon. So it's well armed. It's a good gun platform. And you can upgrade it with some different upgrades here. But it's expensive. I would say that it maybe the theme that I'm going for, I would say big creatures is more what I'm going for instead of big machines. So I would probably, yeah, leave him out. I imagine he'd go better with some of the other Chaos Space Marine chapters. Soul Grinder. I would see him more going with like Chaos Demon type armies. Possibly take him. It's only 135 points. Does have 4 hull points. Does have 4 attacks. Armour is 13 front and side. Rear armour is 11. So we'll check this guy out here. Yeah, Harvester Cannon. Range 48 for a solid shield, shell. Strength 7, AP 4, heavy 3. Pretty good. Flak shell is Skyfire, heavy 3. Interesting for him. Iron Claw. It's quite cheap in points. Times 2 strength, AP 2. Brilliant. It's excellently armed. So this is going to be strength 10. 4 attacks and AP 2. He's brilliant. He's really, really good. Blood for the Blood God. Demon, of course. He's got an inbound save. Can deep strike. Demonic resilience. Vehicle special rule ignores shaken and stunned on 2+. It's excellent. So may take one of the following. There's some upgrades here that may well be interesting. A Baleful Torrent. Strength 6, AP 4, torrent weapon. Very good, 20 points. Yeah, he's got low ballistic skill, but a template weapon doesn't require the ballistic skill, so definitely an option for him. He's a walker, not too fast. So maybe deep striking may well be an option to get him up the table and in position and then let him off. That may well be a good idea for him. Warp Gaze. With range 24, strength 10, AP 1, heavy 1. That is very good. But ballistic skill 3 would mean it wouldn't be too reliable. A phlegm bombardment. His range 36, strength 8, AP 3, large blast, ordnance 1. Again, very good. Excellent weapons here. 30 points to take that. And then a warp sword. Sounds good. Strength for the user, AP 3. Mastercraft and specialist weapon. I can't. Right, I see what's going on here. You can take the warp sword. You know, it's going to give you an extra attack, maybe. Warp sword. It's a melee weapon. And the iron claw is a melee weapon. Okay. So, yeah, you can take it for that. Plus, if this claw is destroyed, if you get weapon destroyed result, you can still keep the one weapon. Yeah, but I probably wouldn't bother with that. I'd just keep the claw and then maybe take the Baleful Torrent. Might be a good weapon to have. Interesting, but it's a low starting points cost for that. So maybe we'll include one in the force. Got the Hellbrute here, which looks okay. Not too keen on the model. Do like the Chaos Dreadnought that you get in with the Dark Vengeance set. Maybe try and do something with that. So it's all pretty much a standard Dreadnought here. Yeah, we'll check him out. There might be some interesting things, but I'll probably not go down the route of Dreadnoughts. So he's crazed. You roll a d3 again. Hellbrute is immobilized to the end of your turn if unengaged. Fires all of its weapons twice. If possible, the target must be a unit that caused one or more glancing or penetrating hits on the Hellbrute in the previous turn. On 2, Rising Fury. Immediately recovers from Crew Shaken and has Rage. Or 3, Hellbrute immediately recovers from any Crew Stunned and Crew Shaken result. It has Fleet and Rage until the end of the turn. If during the turn of shooting phase the Hellbrute has not been maximum charge range of enemy units, it must run as far as possible towards the enemy. If this is not possible for any reason, it must fire its weapons as normal. So yeah, a bit random, and I'm not too keen on the look of the model. Yeah, and I would leave that. Skull Cannon I would leave as well. I rate this the lowest out of all of the models. Just looks horrendous. I can't see that intimidating the opponent at all. So I would leave out the Skull Cannon. Maybe leave it in the comment section what you think of that, but I'm not impressed with that at all. Very, very odd looking model. Right, so on to Lords of War here. So you've got Lord of Skulls. I've heard some people be negative about it, but I actually quite like the model. It's a huge thing. You can see the size of it here compared to the miniatures. And it's a good way of increasing the points value of your army quite quickly. I mean, for you know, almost adding 1,000 points here to your force just getting one model. It's a big thing. So if you get an 1850 point armor, you can quickly get it near 3,000 points just by getting him. You know, it could be a centerpiece to your army. You can make your army up to 3,000 points, play bigger games, or you can swap him in and out of your 1850 point force just to add some variety. Your opponent may have a Lord of War sized unit as well, you know, and these two can sort of face off against each other. Good fun. Like the color scheme. It echoes the sort of theme that I would do if I was collecting these, that red, deep kind of red, the rusty old kind of metal, and then the gold trim and the skulls and that kind of bone colour. I think is that whole colour scheme is echoed throughout this, so you would fit in really well with the rest of the force. As I said, it's 888 points, so is it worth that amount? So, weapon skill 4, ballistic skill 3, which is a bit of a letdown. Strength 10 as standard, armor 13, front side, rear is 11, initiative 3, 4 attacks, and then hull points 9. So pretty good, not amazingly impressive, but I think some of these other rules and weapons on this thing are quite pretty good. It's a super heavy walker, So the standard loadout here is a Ghoulstorm cannon. We'll look these up. We're expecting them to be pretty apocalyptic. He just looks strange. Just looks so grim. You smash and drive over anything. These big white tracks. So Ghoulstorm cannon, 812. It's Hellstorm. It's a huge template weapon. Strength 8, AP 3. So yeah, it is nasty. The whole idea of this is to get close again, which is the idea behind the force. Now it's going to be an attacking force, so that would fit in nicely. A Hades Gatling cannon, I think that's this one here on his arm. Let's have a look. Range 48, decent range, strength 8, AP 3, heavy 12, and pinning. So pretty nasty. Shame he's not ballistic skill 4. It's only half those shots on average you're going to hit, which is a bit of a shame. The Great Cleaver of Khorne, which is a close combat weapon, the big axe. Great Cleaver of Khorne is strength D, remember strength 10, strength D, AP 1, and melee, so nasty weaponry there, strength D, pretty good. So it means this codex, you're not lacking something that's got a nice lot of punch to it. It's just a perfect addition to the codex for these guys. And Demonic Possession, Blood for the Blood God, Demon of Khorne, Bean Frizz, it's got an Infant save as well. Fleet on top of that, it has It Will Not Die, which is handy, a lot of hull points, so you can start getting those back. Rage, so you have four attacks, but you're starting to get some bonuses here. You have Demon Forge, which we've been through already, and then Fueled by Rage, for every hull point the Lord of Skulls has lost, it gains an additional attack. Even if that hull point is later regained. Keep a note of hull points lost. Note that its attack's characteristic cannot exceed 10. So, yeah, he's going to be targeted, and if he starts losing hull points, his attack's characteristic is going to be really high. So you imagine him driving up. He's going to take some hull points as he comes in, but when he reaches the battle line, enemy battle line, he's going to have potentially up to 10 attacks. So, nasty unit. Tracked Behemoth, Lord of Skulls, can tank shock or ram, using Thunder Blitz table in the same manner as a super heavy vehicle. It may not stomp. Right, so, interesting. You may replace the Ghoulstorm cannon with one of the following. So, an Ichor cannon. Yeah, so the Ghoulstorm cannon, that's the Hellstorm. It's a pretty, very decent weapon, so it's got to be pretty good to replace this. Ichor cannon. Strength 7, AP 2. Large blast. Range 48. So, and it's 10 points to do that. I probably wouldn't bother, to be honest. And it's 10 points to do it. It's ballistic skill 3 is not going to be too reliable. Or you can pay to have a Demon Gore Cannon. Demon Gore Cannon is Hellstorm again. Strength 9 this time. Gets hot and instant death. So it's a little bit better. Extra strength. And it has instant death on top of that. So, yeah, nasty enough, but it will cost you 65 points to take that. Okay, maybe you can, but that's quite a lot of points to do it. Then you may replace the Hades Gatling cannon. Remember, I said that wasn't too good because it's ballistic skill 3 with a Skull Hurler. See if that's any good. It's going to be 60 points to do it, but it's range 60, strength 9, AP 3, and then primary weapon and apocalyptic blast. And then successful saving throws against this weapon must be rerolled. That's crazy weapon. Nasty weapon, that one. Even at 60 points, I think that's worth doing. Because you ballistic skill 3, you may scatter, but it's apocalyptic blast. So I think that is an excellent weapon to have. And it'd be nice to have one short range weapon, you know, your Ghoulstorm cannon, and then one long range so that you can start firing straight away and start steadily moving up the table. So that's Lord of Skulls. Then we've gone going on to formations here. You know, you can get some good bonuses from these, but when I build an army, I sort of go for what I like, and then if they fit in with one of the formations, then that's good, and maybe some slight tweaks to get it to fit, but usually just try and stick to what I like in a force. But if you have one HQ, and it can be either Chaos Lord, Demon Prince, a Herald, a Blood Throne, Blood First of Unfettered Fury, and Skulltaker. So yeah, I can do that. 2 to 8 units chosen from the following in any combination. Chaos Space Marines, Berserkers and Bloodletters. Yeah, I can do that. Wonderful units of Possessed. They're forcing you to take a unit of Possessed here. 0 to 2 units of Cultists. 0 to 2 units of Chaos Spawn. Right, so potentially could do that. If you do, you can reroll the result on the Wall of Traits table. Okay. Blood Sacrifice. If a unit of Chaos Cultists from this formation fails a morale check, you can choose to remove the remaining models in the unit's casualties. Right, okay. I'm guessing just to get your blood type points instead. Boon of Khorne. Each time you expend one or more blood type points, choose a second result from the blood type table that has a lower value than the first, but not a value of more than 4. The second result applies to all units in the formation. These effects are in addition to the first result you choose in the blood type table and last until the beginning of your next turn. So you're going to get an extra bonus from the blood type table. It's quite cool. But yeah, I could sort of live without that formation, I think. Brazen Onslaught. 1 to 4 units of Terminators, 2 to 4 units of Blood Crushers. So, yeah, if it took Terminators, it could possibly do this. Is it worth it here, Khorne's Chosen Slaughterers? I say that Terminators for these guys, they do look nice. No, they do look alright. At the start of each fight subphase, check to see if any units in this formation are involved in a combat that contains more enemy models than friendly. Count all models locked in the combat, but just those models that are engaged. If a unit from this formation is outnumbered, all models in that unit add 1 to their attacks until the end of the phase. That's pretty good. 3 attacks there, just for the sake of combining them together, is pretty good. Khorne's Bloodstorm, 2 to 4 units of Raptors, wonderful units of Warped Talons, and 0 to 1 Heldrakes. So quite heavy there on what you have to take. But if you do go down that route, you get Fury of Khorne. Units in this formation have 1 to the strength of any Hammer of Wrath or Vector Strike attacks. So a slight bonus there, nothing too major. Gore Pack is next. 2 to 4 units of Bikers and 1 to 4 units of Flesh Hounds. You get Move Through Cover, Preferred Enemy Psykers, and then run them to ground. Flesh Hound units in this formation have Hammer of Wrath. Chaos Bike units in this formation have the Shred. Special and Resolving Hammer of Wrath. Okay, slight bonus again. I wouldn't say too incredible. I mean, compared to the Eldar upgrades, these aren't too impressive. Carnal Court. An HQ unit chosen from the following: a Demon Prince, a Herald, a Blood Throne, Skull Taker. Yep, and I can do that. 2 to 8 units of Bloodletters. Yep, you have to take 1 to 4 units of Flesh Hounds, 1 to 4 units of Blood Crushers, and 0 to 4 Skull Cannons. If you do, the whole formation gets counter attack. Chosen of Khorne, you can reroll your Warlord traits. Lord of the Blood Host, if this formation's HQ unit is in Deep Strike Reserve, you can choose to reroll reserve rolls for that unit. Other units from this formation arriving from Deep Strike do not scatter as long as the first models within 6 of this formation's HQ, even if they arrive from Deep Strike Reserve during the same turn as it. Right, so there's some bonus to that. The Blood Host Unleashed. Any units have -2 penalty to their leadership characteristic when taking fear test caused by units from this formation. So, yeah, formation, you want this section of the army to cause fear and terror, and then you can reflect it with that -2 penalty. It's pretty good. Pretty good, just to knock up some extra bonuses at no charge. Right, so there they all are, laid out. It's this kind of thing charging towards you. Terrifying. Yeah, pretty good. Pretty good. Right, so we've been through these. We've done the blood type table. I think that's pivotal for this force. Really would try and sort of stick to that and just really reap the benefits of it. So much free stuff you can get. Yeah. Okay, and then you've got your levels of alliance there. And then Warlord traits. You see how good these are. So, Icon of War, your Warlord and all friendly units with the Blood for the Blood God special within 12, reroll foul charge rolls. Not too bad, that's okay. Disciple of Khorne, your warlord has the Zealot special. That's good. If he's a real souped up character on these nasty monsters, then that reroll is going to be pretty cool. Arch Slaughterer, add one to your warlord's attacks characteristic, pretty good. Favourite of Khorne, on a 4, your warlord generates one additional blood type point each time he slays an enemy character in a challenge. Okay, not too bad. Butcher King, on a 5, your warlord has the preferred enemy. Again, pretty good. So this is really homing in on your HQ choice. Personal benefits for him to make him better. Then Destined for Glory, when resolving the Dark Apotheosis or Fury Unbound results in the blood type table, your warlord will automatically pass leadership test if chosen as the character. Okay, so again, it's pretty good. Not too bad. I've sort of been through these. The weapons and the melee weapons. There is some decent stuff here. Can't see why you can't build a decent army from this codex. I wouldn't say it's underpowered at all. Been through those. Okay, just got artifacts here. See if any of these are any good. Just get a hold of the points value cost for them. Yeah, so maybe you've gone for a Chaos Lord and using Terminator Army, looking to give him something that's going to give him a bit more of an edge. So we'll see what you can take here. Because I don't think you can take them if you are Artifacts of Slaughter. Yeah, so Demon Prince can take them. He's in the army. But things like the Bloodthirst of Unfettered Fury and those bigger ones, they can't. So you're looking really to give this to things like the Herald, Demon Prince, Chaos Lord, you know, something that's going to enhance them. So first one is Gore Drinker. It's +1 strength, it's AP2, melee weapon, Blood Feast, and unwieldy. Blood Feast, keep account of all unsaved wounds caused by the bearer's melee attacks. At the start of each of your turns, consult the table below to see what effects Gore Drink will have on its bearer. These effects are cumulative, so the more wounds you cause, you just gradually build all of these up. So, no effect on zero wounds. 1 to 2, you had +1 to your strength. So immediately it becomes strength 7, strength 5 for him. Okay, then 3 to 4 the bearer gains. On top of this, the bearer then gains Rampage, special rule. Okay, pretty good. Then 5 to 7, double the bearer's strength, nasty. Then 8 plus the bearer's melee attacks gain instant death, special rule. Yeah, so that's good, but on top of it being +1 strength, and AP2, and yeah, so it is a pretty good enhancement, but it will cost 30 points. Yeah, not too bad, to be honest. Not too bad, okay. So yeah, may well be tempting to take this, but add it to a Demon Prince and you're enhancing him pretty good. The Bloodforged Armor is a 3+ save. Eternal Warrior and Feel No Pain, and that will cost 50 points, a lot of points. Yeah, a lot of points. We're just wondering here, look, if you look at the Doom Prince, Warpforged Armor's 20. So, for an extra 30 points, you'll get your 3+ armor anyway, and then you get Feel No Pain on top of that. Yeah, maybe it's still quite a lot. Alright, next one, the Brazen Rune. The bearer of the Brazen Rune has the Adamantium Wheel special rule. Furthermore, once per game, start of your opponent's psychic phase, you can declare the bearer is unleashing the power behind the Brazen Rune. For the rest of the phase, any enemy psychic within 24 that attempts to manifest a psychic power rolls any double will suffer perils of the warp. At the end of the phase in which the Brazen Rune's power is unleashed, the bearer loses the Adamantium special rule. Right, so, yeah, not bad if you're trying to protect yourself against Psykers. 15 points to it. It's not too heavy in points cost for that upgrade. Right, then Blade of Endless Bloodshed. It's strength of the user, AP3, melee, and then deluge of gore. At the end of any assault phase in which the bearer inflicted one or more casualties, the controlling player generates one blood type point in addition to any others he generated during that phase. Just a little extra bonus for that one. Shouldn't expect that to be too much. 35 points is a fair old amount there. Yeah, that's a lot of points for that. Power weapon of AP3 is usually just 15 points. You pay an extra 20 points just for that Deluge of Gore rule. The Skull Helm of Khorne. The bearer of the Skull Helm of Khorne has Fear. Special rule, in addition, every time the bearer of the Skull Helm rolls a 6 to hit in close combat, he can immediately make another attack at the same initiative step. However, these bonus attacks cannot confer additional attacks. If for every 6, you get an extra attack. But it's alright. Skull Helm of Gore. Skull Helm of Khorne is 15 points. Not too bad. Not too bad. If it's a character that's got a lot of attacks, then you know, the more attacks, the more value that is. Collelcting the Axe of Ruin. Strength for the user, AP2. Melee, Caged Fury, Decapitating Blow, and Specialist Weapon. Decapitating Blow, any twin rolls of 6 of instant death. It's pretty good. Again, if you've got lots of attacks, it's cool. Then Caged Fury, if the bearer of the Axe of Ruin is reduced to 0 wounds or is otherwise removed as casualty, a Bloodthirst of Unfettered Fury is summoned within 6 of that character before he is removed. At the end of each of the controlling player's remaining turns, the Bloodthirst automatically loses D3 wounds. Invulnerable saves are allowed against these wounds, as normal. Other saves are not. So this Bloodthirster appears, it's gradually going to die. So it might last a turn or two. That's pretty cool. It was very cool to have that turn. Another cool thing where things just materialise. That will cost 60 points. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, it's going to happen every now and then in the game. Yeah, interesting that one. Interesting. So those are interesting there. You can take those if you want. Some of them seem okay. So then you've got tactical objectives, specifically, and then just the summary just at the end. So that's the codex review for Khorne Daemonkin. It's nice they've got their own codex. I like the theme behind the army, as I said, sort of this kind of colour scheme here. The browns and the reds look nice, sort of the old bone, the rusty look. I would be tempted to put sort of blood splatters, a sort of dark and dried sort of blood kind of look. Would look quite cool. And then the idea behind the army would have to be a core, sort of the force that would march up the table to get into melee and to shoot, and then other stuff, deep strikes, or materialises, and the force just gets bigger the closer it gets to the enemy. So it'd be an assault-based army, I think. And then it would have an element of what's on foot and advancing forwards, and then this other stuff that turns up. And I would really go for things like the monstrous creatures, the new big models that they've done, just for the intimidation factor and just for the look of it. Something to try and scare and intimidate your opponent. I think that's, if you can manage to do that, you know, if you put your army out on the table and your opponent says, "Cool, what, you know, that looks incredible," and yeah, they're actually intimidated by it, then you've accomplished it. When you have this army of Khorne Daemonkin. But that's my take on it. In the comments section, leave your thoughts, what you think of the units that I've highlighted, the ones that I think that I would have, and the idea behind the force. If you're experienced in using these, what do you think of the new codex? Has it improved? I think it's a decent codex, so I can't see any reason why you can't build a decent army from this. What units are good? What units you'd leave out? And then there'll be people coming onto this review, and they'll read the comments and get your advice from there. As I mentioned, I've got the codex from gamingfigures.com. So they do Games Workshop 15% off, an extra 5% off on top of that if your order comes to over £100. And then in the UK, there's free postage on orders as well. So that's the review for Khorne Daemonkin. Thanks for watching, and tune in next time.